Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exalt, we edify, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about Satan's two goals against Christ's disciples. Satan's two goals against Christ's disciples. And our case study will be the biblical disciples from the Bible in the time of Jesus and the 21st century disciples. I'm a disciple of Jesus because I'm saved, and to the best of my ability, I live by the Bible every day by the grace of God. You see, if you are saved and you live by the Word of God every day of your life, you are not just talking the talk, you are walking the walk, then you are a disciple. So we are going to be the case study with our brothers and sisters from the time of Jesus. But before we start, let us pray. Father, we thank you. Oh, you are so beautiful. You are wise in heart and mighty in strength. Who has hardened himself against you and prospered? It has never happened. And so, Lord, we come in total surrender to hear from you. Teach us, Holy Spirit. Glorify Jesus in us through this message. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right. Our foundation text is going to be John chapter 10, verse 10a. If you're a Bible student, you ought to start saying that right now. And if you're not a Bible student, I'm challenging you. Become one, okay? John 10, 10a. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. There you have the mission statement of Satan as defined by Jesus himself. That's all the devil is out to do in the lives of every one of us. All right? Now, Satan's primary goal is to deceive everybody. He's a thief, can't help himself, I tell people. He can't help stealing. He can't help killing. He can't help destroying. That is mission statement in the lives of everyone. But if you're a child of God, the devil can't do that to you. Oh, no. Mm-mm. Now, his primary goal is to deceive everybody. However, for a disciple of Jesus, like myself, like yourself, if you have been saved, we have escaped that satanic madness. The fact that we have received Jesus, it means the devil could now deceive us into not believing that Jesus is real and that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Nevertheless, even though we have escaped satanic attack of deception not to receive Jesus, we have received Jesus, we have escaped that attack, the devil still has two more goals up his sleeves against us. Now, let's look at them. What are Satan's two goals against you as a Christ, as Christ's disciple, against me as Christ's disciple? Number one is to disrupt you. The devil wants to disrupt you, wants to disrupt me. This is Satan's attempt, listen up, to get you to shut up, you see, and not preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And at this point, I will quickly take a second to bless God for one of my prodigies that I mentor spiritually, God used that individual really to give me the background to this message. And the individual came to me and said, do you know that if the devil can't get you not to believe Jesus, then the devil will try to make you to shut up. And if the devil can't make you to shut up, then the devil will try to let you, make you lose your reward. And I was like, oh, that sounds like a sermon to me. So I quickly scribbled it. And I told the individual, I would like to give the individual the credit. And the person said, I don't want any credit. So I just want to thank God for the life of that person. Now, the devil is out to make us to shut up and not preach the gospel. This is usually through external forces of persecutions. Because of our biblical view. Listen up, please. Our opinions are bound to offend some, to anger some, and make some uncomfortable. So don't go on popularity contests. If they don't like you because of your Christianity, listen up. You are doing it right, okay? You are doing it right if they don't like you. Jesus said, if they hated me, they would hate you. So if they hate you for your kind of Christianity, oh, you are going overboard with this, your Jesus, your Christianity is too chronic. What kind of Christianity are you practicing? You don't do this, you don't do that. It's because you're doing it right, okay? So because our Christianity angers some, makes some to be uncomfortable or offend some, as a result, the devil will use people to, number one, deride us, or threaten us, or punish, or even want to kill us. You see, all these are satanic attempts to make us hide our Bibles and keep our biblical opinions to ourselves. That's all. This happened to the disciples. And it's still happening to today. At this point, I remember a wonderful Pakistani sister, Sister Asia Bibi. She's been on death row for the past 5 years. She's a mother of five. She became a child of God. And right now, we are just praying that she will be released. You see, she's been in jail on death row for 5 years in Pakistan because of her faith in Jesus Christ. She was given the chance to recount and she said no. You see, the devil is trying to shut Sister Bibi to shut her up. But praise God, that sister is holding on. Look at her brothers and sisters in Syria, in Iraq, Iran, China, Russia, many parts of Africa. They experience this disruption every day. Every day, you see. And let's go to the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 17 to 18. Acts 4, 17 to 18. This happened after God did a miracle through Peter and John. And the Pharisees, they became mad because now many people were believing in Jesus in Jerusalem. And they said, but so this does not spread any further among the people, that is the gospel, let us, listen up, severely threaten them that from now on, they do not speak to anyone in this name. In what name? In the name of Jesus, you see. So they called them, they called Peter and John, and commanded them not to speak at all, nor teach in the name of Jesus. You see, it's still the same thing. Now, for you as a believer, I want you to know that all the devil is trying to do is to shut you up. If you do not force your biblical view on anyone, do not let anyone force their cynical view on you. Let me say that again, because I tell people that even though we are Christians, we also have our constitutional rights according to the law of the country we live in. If you are not shoving the Bible in the face of your colleagues at work, if you are not forcing them to listen to your Christian music, nobody has the right to force their paganistic view on you. No. If you do not force your biblical view on anyone, do not let anyone force their cynical view on you. Moving on. The second goal of the enemy is to deny you. First, to disrupt you, to get you to shut up. If that is not possible, then the devil will want to deny you. Deny you of what? This is Satan's attempt to get you to lose your reward in heaven through internal or external forces or spiritual pollution. You see, Dr. Rogers said, if the devil tries persecution and doesn't work with you, then the devil will try prostitution. You see, the devil is a dirty dealer. You see, it can come through personal, unconfessed sin, as it happened to Ananias and Sapphira. These were members of the first century church. They sold their land, their own personal land, because everybody, they were selling what they had, and they were bringing it to the apostles so they could buy food and share the food among themselves to the widows, the less privileged. So they sold the land, and they put part of the money into their personal pocket. And they brought the rest of the money, and Apostle Peter said, by the Spirit of God, is this the total amount? Oh yeah! And Peter said, why have you decided to lie to the Holy Spirit? And right there, Ananias died. His wife, Sapphira, came a few hours later, and Peter said, is this how much you sold the land for? Oh yes! Why have you decided to join your husband to lie to the Holy Spirit? Boom! She also fell down and died. I personally believe that we are going to see Ananias and Sapphira in heaven because they were counted as part of those who believed in the first century church. But they were judged right there and then with untimely death because they did not confess and repent from their lies, you know. They lied to the Holy Spirit, they lied to the Church of God, you see. So by doing that, by dying untimely in that sin, they will miss out on the reward when they get to heaven, you see. Now, that is internal. Now, the devil can now use external seduction to adulterate the message of Jesus Christ. How is that possible? While the salvation of a genuine believer is unconditional, obtaining a heavenly reward is conditional. You work for your rewards in heaven, but salvation is free. Let me say that again. Salvation is free, but you have to work for your rewards in heaven, you see. So the devil will want to deny you by bringing you into, by allowing you to go into sin, either personally or using external forces to seduce you, to pollute what you are preaching, if you are not careful, and if you fall into that temptation. Believers who practice polluted Christianity will lose their rewards in heaven. Listen up. I don't care if you are a bishop, archbishop, Pope, whatever title you go by. If your Christianity is polluted, you talk the talk, but you don't walk the walk, even though you have been truly saved, but you do some things in secret and you think your secret is safe, listen up. You are polluting your Christianity and there's no reward for you in heaven. It doesn't matter if you build a old cathedral for God, it does not matter. No reward. So you can still change. Let's go to James chapter 1 verse 12. The book of James chapter 1 verse 12. Blessed is the man who endures temptation,
For when he has been approved, that is, when you don't fall into that temptation, and we get home, you are, that means you'll be approved. You will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. If you love your Jesus enough, if I love my Jesus enough, there is nothing so beautiful, so wonderful, that will make me to want to disobey him. No amount of gold or silver. Oh no, you see. So if your love for Jesus is not higher than money, possessions, or whatever it is, then you've got some work to do. All right? To obey him is to be blessed eternally. To disobey him is to regret eternally. Now, Joseph and Zion, stop. You are going to say that again for some Christians who are walking in their Christian walk in a polluted way. Because this is the time of repentance. Now tell them again. To obey him is to be blessed eternally. To disobey him is to regret eternally. If you are walking in a polluted way, if your Christianity is polluted, change. Change. Moving on. Now we've talked about the two goals, which are to disrupt and to deny. How do you frustrate Satan's goals against you? How do I frustrate Satan's goals against me? Number one, refuse to be intimidated. Just because we are Christians doesn't mean we are powerless. Oh no, we have a fighting Jesus. Are you kidding me? We refuse intimidation through daily Bible study of God's word. You see, that's your powerhouse. That is your sword. Never, ever play around with the word of God. You need the word of God every day. This keeps our eyes on the Lord and gives us divine perspective on issues. We also reject intimidation through prayer. Now listen up. By asking God for divine strength, boldness, wisdom, patience, and so on, so we can withstand and not break. Alright? We ask God to open the eyes of those who are spiritually blind. These are people who, although do not agree with our biblical beliefs, they do not hate us. Oh no. And they don't attack us for our beliefs. I tell people, my colleagues that I worked with a few years back, they were not Christians. In fact, there were Hindus among them, Muslims, and a few that were born into Christian families. They do their own thing, really. But these people never gave me any grief for one day because of my Christian beliefs. Oh no. I preach to them and they're like, But they never gave me any trouble. For people like that, if you have them in your family or in your workplace, the devil has blinded their spiritual eyes. For people like that, the prayer you pray is God open their spiritual eyes, soften their heart towards the gospel. All right? That's one kind of prayer. Now, here is another kind of prayer. You pray warfare prayer against those who are incensed against you. And we stop at nothing to destroy you because of your biblical view. There are some people, oh my goodness, they are looking for every way for you to make mistakes at work so they can report you to your boss and get you fired. Why? It's not because they hate your skin color. Oh no, they are colorblind. It's not because they hate your gender. They can't be bothered. But because you're a Christian, they're out to destroy you. For people like that, don't pray, oh Lord, open their eyes. No, you pray some Davidic prayer. Go into the book of Psalms. Break the arm of the wicked. Lord, their cheekbone. Those are the kinds of prayer you pray against the enemy. Why? Because they are filled with hate and anger against Jesus, the gospel, and you as a genuine believer. Such people, now listen up, because some may be saying, Joseph is dying, but Jesus said we should pray for our enemies. Yes, all kinds of prayers, okay? Such people have been obsessed or possessed by demonic spirits. When somebody has been possessed by demonic spirits, oh no, you don't pray, oh Lord, let their spiritual eyes be open. Oh no, you rebuke that demon inside of them. You have to. The disciples prayed warfare prayers when persecutions arose in Jerusalem, and God took care of King Herod. I'm telling you, God took care of that king. He was a horrible person. God still deals with antagonistic demonic agents today. That's who they are. They are demonic agents. They are not ordinary human beings. No. When we pray so that the gospel is not hindered, I can begin to give you examples of my personal experience, but time will fail me. I mean, God dealt with one so particularly, it's unbelievable. She resigned herself, and she was my supervisor. She resigned. By the time the Lord finished dealing with her, you see. So we pray the prayer of their eyes to be open. If they are not out to destroy us, they just don't want to listen to the gospel. But if they are demonic agents that they want to destroy us, not for anything personal, but because of the gospel, then you change the game. Alright? 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6, we stop at 7. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 6 to 7. Since it is a righteous thing with God to repay with tribulation those who trouble you, you see, and to give you, us who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. See, it's a righteous thing. It is a righteous thing. Until you know your spiritual authority, the physical world will continue to trample you down. Let me say that bread on the go again. So beautiful. Until you know your spiritual authority, the physical world will continue to trample you down. Moving on. Refuse to be infiltrated. Although we are on our way to heaven, unfortunately, we are still in an imperfect body. You see, we are not perfect yet. This means we still have a slippery moment of sin. Since the work of Satan is to use sin to infiltrate our camp so as to destroy us from the inside. You see, don't look at the other person, yourself. You have an enemy on the inside. It's called flesh. The devil can use it at any time if you are not careful. And it works so well with the devil, you see. So let's look at ourselves from the inside. The devil wants to use our flesh to destroy us. So when you fall into sin, please, as a child of God, learn to confess your sin immediately. I mean, the devil hates that. Ooh, the devil hates for you to confess. The devil hates it. Learn to confess immediately and let your brethren, your brothers and sisters in Christ, let them know what has happened to you so they can give you spiritual support. Say what? They will be laughing at me. They will be talking about me. If you are among people like that, then they are not saved. Oh yeah, they are not saved. General believers, when they see one person fall into sin, guess what? They rally. Because they know if it happens to this brother or to this sister, it can happen to me. They rally and they come around you against the enemy. We have one enemy, and his name is the devil. So if you are still among people, we will make your sin the front page of your newspaper in your local place, then you need to look for real, genuine children of God. Similarly, keep the company of fellow believers. I don't understand all these Christians that they say they are saved and their best friends they're into Rainbow Club or whatever they are called, and I don't understand that. There's no communion between the table of the Lord and the table of demons. No, that is wrong. Learn to move with fellow believers to avoid being cornered by sin. Iron sharpened iron, the Bible says. This is very important for your spiritual growth, for my spiritual growth, and for my spiritual safety, and for your spiritual safety. Refuse to be induced by external forces who, with promises of incentives that may support personal well-being, are trying to lure you to dilute the word of God. To do so is to your own detriment. Oh, Lord have mercy. If I start giving you examples in this ministry, how some people have tried to lure us, because they, as far as they are concerned, our sermons in this ministry is too strong. You see, people are dying and going to hell, and some people are saying your preaching is too hard. Excuse me? Revelations chapter 22, verse 12, the book of Revelation. I'm sorry. Chapter 22, verse 12. And behold, this is Jesus speaking to you and I am coming quickly. Come, Lord Jesus. And my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. You see. So if you remember that Jesus is coming, do not dilute the word of God. Preach it as it is written in the Bible. Live from the inside out and see how little you struggle with holiness. Let's say that again. Live from the inside out and see how little you struggle with holiness. Meaning, whatever you want to do in the secret, ask yourself, can I do this openly? If you live by that, you won't have so much trouble with holiness. Amen. All right, what have we done so far? What are Satan's two goals against Christ's disciples? To disrupt you. This is when the devil uses external forces to try to shut down the preaching of the gospel. To deny you. This is when we yield to our internal proclivities to sin or external seductions to dilute our faith walk. The result is loss of heavenly rewards. How can we frustrate Satan's two goals in our lives? Number one, refuse to be intimidated. We are to enforce the victory of the cross through daily Bible study for unclouded vision and prayer to quench all anti-gospel arrows. Refuse to be infiltrated. We are to stay true by living out our Christian life as written in the Bible, disregarding the consequences that may arise because of it. Now let's conclude. Are you facing persecutions today because of your testimony of Jesus Christ? Huh? You're saying, Josephine Zion, I don't even know if I'm going to have a job by the end of December because this, my boss, can barely tolerate me now because of my Christianity. Be encouraged. All right, sister, brother, be encouraged. You are not alone. Because Jesus is with you. You are going somewhere because heaven is your home. You have a hope for your persecution because your persecution will be rewarded. All right? Hang in there. The Lord was, is, and will always be faithful. Okay? Let us be faithful to the faith. Be faithful to the fight. Be faithful to the finish. May the Lord uphold you May the Lord uphold me, and may the Lord uphold all of us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you are yet to give your life to Jesus, oh, listen, I feel so sorry for you.
Say what?
Yeah, I'm sorry for you, for your life. And really, I'm scared for you. You may appear to be having it good for now, but it's not gonna last. I promise you on the authority of the Word of God, that good time you think you are having without Jesus is not going to last. Oh no. The devil has planned a rough journey that will end in the lake of fire ahead of you. However, you can still escape by renouncing the devil and embracing Jesus. This may just be your very last chance. I heard that Cassidy died yesterday, you see. I hope he knew the Lord. But how many people have died in the last 2 days that they call celebrities? This may be your very last chance too, you see. Because you can't just give your heart to Jesus at any time you like. Oh no. It takes the Holy Spirit to draw you. So you can't say, I will do it tomorrow. No. If the Holy Spirit is telling you right now, you know she's telling the truth. You need to give your heart to Jesus. Listen up. That is the chance you have, because now the Holy Spirit is drawing you. Don't lose your chance. I'm going to say a quick prayer. And after I finish, a link is coming up. Click on that link and we will meet you there. All right? Father, in Jesus' name, your word has gone out. For us believers, make us strong. Help us to be faithful. And keep us, O Lord, by the strength of your arm, from evil arrows of the enemy. And for those who are going to give their souls and their hearts to you, Jesus, I pray, open their eyes. Let them understand what they are about to do. The contract they are about to sign with you that will save their soul from eternal lake of fire. Thank you, Jesus. For in Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen and amen. Listen up. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.